Greetings across whatever you watch stuff on. This is the Silent Comedy Watch Party, a somewhat regularly scheduled live-streamed silent film presentation with live musical accompaniment and introductions from our place to yours and vice versa. Welcome to your own silent movie theater. I'm one of your hosts. I'm Ben Modell. We'll start our show in a couple of minutes. We always like to go live a minute or two early just to make sure all of our engines are firing on all cylinders, and you can make sure you're all getting settled in. But we do have a minute or so before we start.
Yes. So if you're on the East Coast of the U.S. or Canada with us today, you have a little time to microwave some popcorn, perhaps this afternoon. If you're our friends on the West Coast of the U.S. and Canada, you have some time to maybe make a little lunch or brunch to share with us today. To our friends in Europe and Scandinavia, perhaps you're snuggling in with a nightcap or a cup of tea. And to all of our friends all over the world in all of the time zones, welcome to our living room. We can't wait to share some laughs with you today.
Thank you, Mona. We'll be starting in just a moment. Here's a couple of minutes, a couple of seconds of music. Here we go. Happy Sunday, everybody. Happy Sunday, Mona. Thanks so much for joining in. I'm Ben Modell. I'm a silent film accompanist, historian, and presenter. And welcome to the Silent Comedy Watch Party. Hi.
Hi, everybody.
Hi. It's so good to see you. So good to see you again. I know it's been a couple of weeks. Good to be with you. And thanks for having us over to watch some funny old movies together. In this virtual cinema we've all created together, we're watching movies together. We're not sitting. Well, maybe you're sitting next to somebody, but we're not all gathered in the same physical space. But we're all together in the silent movie theater in this. I don't know if metaverse is that the right word. I've just learned about this concept. But we're so glad to see you. This is a live stream. This is actually happening right now, just on the other side of your device or your TV.
From our living room.
Thank you. Yes, from our living room to yours. In a moment, I'll be joined by my co-host, Steve Massa, who along with his wife, Susan, who is co-piloting by text with my wife, Mona, is safely ensconced in his place. This is 100% live. None of this is pre-recorded. So we're so glad to see you. This is our 73rd live streamed episodes since we launched the show in March of 2020. We're so glad we could be together, giving you some laughs to help you get through what you're going through or whatever you've got coming up. We want to wish you happy holidays.
Yay.
And all the best for the current holiday season. It's been quite a year, and it's been great being able to share these films with you and help entertain you with these programs, and it's also meant so much to us. It gives us a way to anchor our week.
Yes.
I can't tell you what a difference and how much it's meant doing these shows. It's not just like me showing up at a theater and playing the piano, taking a bow and leaving. But there's, even though I can't see you, I feel like there's some, we're connected. And when I go to When I do an in-person show and I go like this during my bow or intro, there's a bunch of people who go like this, and I could tell from the eye contact that we watched the show.
So sweet. So,
yeah. There's somebody at the show I played in Bedford, New York, last week, and who had their watch party T-shirt on. So
Yay. That's
great. Want to thank Mom, my wife, Mona Allen,
for helping. You're so welcome. I'm so excited to see these movies today.
Yes. Yay. Yeah. So thank you, Mona. I want to thank also, like I mentioned before, Steve's wife, Susan, co-piloting Woo-hoo! The show from their place. Together with Mona, I want to
thank you, Susan.
Thank you, Susan. And thank you, Crystal Cutty, our associate producer, and keeps so very much going along behind the scenes.
Thank you, Crystal.
Yeah, thank you. And not just for the Silent Comedy Watch Party, but also for my DVD projects that are percolating. I also want to thank Marlene Weissman,
yes.
who designs our graphics, our logos, and this wonderful triptych.
Woohoo! Thank you, Marlene.
For every single week. And if you really like the logo and want to help and support Marlene, why not go over to Redbubble and get a watch party mask, a tote bag, throw pillow, you name it. There's like 60 something products you can get there, and your purchase of a watch party item supports Marlene.
Yeah, so all proceeds go.
Yeah, exactly. So thank you very much, and then thank you. Thanks for watching. Thanks for posting comments. Thanks for sending in emails. I know somebody last week, looked up there's an item in the Our Gang film that Mickey Daniels was holding of Sherlock Holmes, and somebody identified exactly which picture of William Gillette that was.
Wow.
So little things like that, it's always fun because we've become part of a virtual cinema audience together. So because I can't see you, I'm looking at the back of an iPhone. I imagine you, and so the comments and everything we hear from you is our way of connecting. I also want to thank you for anyone who has sent in a contribution. We're doing this for free for you on YouTube. Those of you who have been so able and so motivated to send in a contribution by PayPal, Venmo, SquareUp, you name it, it means a lot to us. We thank you so much for that.
Yes. That's not why we do it.
Exactly. So so I think that's all of the thank yous. We've got a great program lined up for you today. This is one of our two one-reelers, one two-reeler program. And this is our last live stream show for the year 2021.
Yes,
we'll be continuing in the new year. And we'll keep you posted about all of that. But before I get too mushy about all that, let's I'll bring on Steve. Here's Steve Massa. Hey, Steve.
Hey, everybody.
Steve.
Hi, how are
you? Happy holidays. Fine.
Yeah.
Very well.
Oh, great. Good to see you virtually.
Virtually.
Yeah. Actually, Steve and I got to see each other in person recently, so it's, you know, because we do live in the city, it is possible for us to cross paths in person. So.
Yeah, and we actually went to Silver Springs, Maryland, too.
That's right.
We had a road trip.
The first one in what, 2 years?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, for you. And again, you know, we saw a lot of this from the audiences. So it was a lot of fun to get to do that. Yeah. Yes, Mom.
And I'm hearing some fan noise on Steve's end.
Oh yeah. I was going to mention it too.
Yeah. I have this. Tell everybody what that
if
is.
You hear what sounds like a projector, it's a fan on my computer, and I put an ice pack on it, and usually that helps. But today it's not cooperating.
Yeah.
So just think of it as a projector sound.
Yeah.
Yeah. So. So just so you know, you're not crazy. It's just Steve's computer. But it's a good hack to try. If you're on Zoom and it says internet connection is slow, and it's fine, put an ice pack under your device, and it's usually something called thermal throttling that I learned about in doing these shows. But we've got enough tech help. Steve, why don't you tell everybody a little bit about our Snub Pollard comedy that we're kicking off the show with today?
Okay, well, for our opener, like Ben said, we've got Snub Pollard and Marie Moschini in Raise the Rent, and this is from 1920. And here's a exhibitor ad with a big headshot of Snub with his droopy Fu Manchu mustache, I guess you would call it, yeah. You know, or upside down Kaiser Wilhelm mustache, yeah. Going down. And this is pretty early in Snub's series. His solo series started in 1919 for Hal Roach, and this is early 1920, so it's about 15 shorts in. It's a, sort of his 15th starring short. And Marie Moschini is his leading lady, and we've kind of highlighted the ladies for this episode. And hey. Marie started, here's a kind of a formal portrait of her. She started at the Roach Studio, I think it was around 1916 or 17, as sort of the Girl Friday. She was their secretary, but she did everything. She did whatever was needed. She'd help sew costumes. She says she helped patch films when they needed prints patched. Wow. Mm-hmm. So she did everything. But she started playing bits in the Harold Lloyd shorts, like first Lonesome Luke and then his early Glasses character. And then she started getting larger and larger parts. And then when Harold had his accident, that enabled Snub to kind of be launched into his own series because they needed to keep product going at the studio. And at first, Mildred Davis was used as Snub's leading lady because she had been Harold's leading lady and they wanted to keep her busy. But when Harold came back and started working again, Mildred went back to work with Harold, so they promoted Marie to become Snub's leading lady. And she's great. She did tons of shorts with Snub. She and Snub were teamed in a lot of these shorts. And then she went on to work with Will Rogers and some of the other comics, Paul Parrott, a little bit at the Roach Studio. And she left the Roach Studio around 1924. And she did work with Charles Puffy at Universal and a few things here and there. Eventually, she retired from the screen. And then in 1930, she married Dr. Lee DeForest, of phonofilm fame. He was the creator of the, Odeon tube? Odeon tube?
Yeah, these are sound films that were sound on film process from the early 20s. Yeah.
So that was his claim to fame, and she married Dr. Lee DeForest. And she, retired from performing. This film also has the regular, members of the Hal Roach Stock Company. Here you see Sunshine Sammy, Ernie Morrison, isn't in this one, which is kind of a rarity because he's usually in the snub shorts. But he doesn't turn up in this one. But the other fellow holding the book, Eddie Boland, he does turn up. Mm-hmm. And he actually, at that time, had his own series. And the woman next to him was his wife, who was in the shorts, whose name was Jean Hope. So we have a pretty good selection of the Roach Stock Company. And this particular short was directed by Fred Neumeier. And if you know the name Fred Neumeier, it's because he directed most of the early, or co-directed with Sam Taylor, most of the early Harold Lloyd features, like Grandma's Boy, Safety Last, The Freshman. Yeah. So, but here he's directed a couple of these early things with Snub.
Yeah.
But we can talk more about Neumeier's career and some of the other people. I think we should go ahead and take a look at Raise the Rent.
All right. Thanks so much, Steve. All right. Very good. Thanks so much. This is a Raise the Rent with Snub Pollard. We want to thank Rick Scheckman for sharing the file of the film in his archive with us so we can share it with you.
Thank you, Rick.
Thank you, Rick. Mon, if you'll get the lights.
Sure.
We've got it all threaded up. We got all the ones and zeros in the right order, I hope. Here is Raise the Rent with Snub Pollard and Marie Moschini. Yeah, lots of fun.
And it's, you know what? It's almost like what's going on in New York City these days. We're trying to rent apartments.
Oh my gosh, it's really crazy. Yeah. Yeah, it's a lot of fun, and it's really well made. I mean, the structure and the pacing and the inventiveness of the gags, it's really a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's very timely, like Mana's saying.
You know,
it's still the housing shortages and whatever. Yeah. And so, yeah, it's very timely. It's well made. And Neumeier was a very good comedy director.
Yeah, he definitely was.
He went on. I mean, he did those great early things, those features for Harold. Mm. But then he went on and he did kind of freelance around. He worked with Larry Seaman. He directed a number of the late 20s features with Reginald Denny.
Oh, okay.
Although Denny said that he and Neumeier didn't get along as well as he and William Sider.
Oh, okay.
Because he felt that he and Sider were really on the same page.
Yeah.
But still, they made some very good things. And then in sound film, his career didn't do quite as well. He ended up going back to Roach, the Hal Roach studio, and he directed a couple of Our Gang shorts, and he directed the Our Gang feature, General Spanky.
Oh.
He directed that, which has been shown lately a number of times on TCM.
Mm.
So he had a long career. I mean, he had been a baseball player early in his career. He was a ball player, and he got out of that, and then he became an extra at Universal around 1914, and then he worked his way up to doing odd things. But that's sort of where he met Roach, Hal Roach, and Harold Lloyd, because they were all extras. You know, they were all starting together in like 1914. So they got friendly, and as they, you know, Roach set up his own shop and started hiring people. He hired all these people that he knew, you know, that they had been working together early.
Mm-hmm.
And so Neumeier worked his way up to being, he played parts in the Lonesome Luke and the early Lloyd films, but then he started contributing gags and then, you know, became a director. So you see, again, a lot of the Roach supporting people, and a lot of them are doing double duty. You see a lot of them. The only one I think that doesn't play two roles is Sammy Brooks, because he's so little. It's easy to spot him.
It's easy to spot him,
but he and Snub have a pretty knockabout routine together out on the stairs, the steps of that building.
Often Sammy Brooks will show up, and the gag is that he's a very short person, and then that's it. But he's got the whole he's got all that whole sequence together with them.
Yeah, but they're usually kind of rough with him. They knock him down, or they jump over him because he's so little. But he was supposedly a kind of a tough little guy from all the stories. But he, you know, he had been in vaudeville. He was part of a troupe of little people called Lasky's Hobos. He was part of that, and he was in tours of like Snow White, you know, being one of the dwarves and things. So he worked quite a bit before he got into movies. I'm trying to think of some of the other people. Oh, the guy who is taking their furniture out and dumps it in the middle of the field. That's Gaylord Lloyd. That's Harold's brother.
Oh, okay.
And William Gillespie turns up a couple of times. He's the person that moves into the house at one point and makes Snub and Marie leave, and then he's a couple other parts. So,
and who is Eddie Boland? Who does Eddie Boland play?
Is he the landlord? He's the guy that sells the house.
Right.
And so tells them they have to get out.
So if you've seen the movie Sunrise, Eddie Boland is the guy in Sunrise. There's a sequence at the dance hall where there's a woman whose strap keeps falling down. He keeps putting it back up. That's Eddie Boland. If he looks familiar, I know. That's how I know him.
He also has a good role in the Kid Brother.
Kid Brother, right? He's the guy with the traveling circus in Kid Brother.
Yeah, he and Constantine Romanoff,
yeah,
and Jobina are the people from the traveling circus, traveling show.
Yeah,
but he did a lot of stuff. He worked until in the mid 30s, but for a while he had his own one reel series for the Hal Roach studio. And then he went on, he worked a lot at Educational with Lloyd Hamilton, and then he did a lot of bits, you know, roles and features.
Mm.
So yeah, he was a regular, and Noah Young turns up at one point.
Oh.
Very briefly. He's the guy when they're trying to get, there's a whole line of people.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, we're sold out. Go back to the asylum or whatever.
Yeah.
He
oh,
says,
that's know. Noah Young. Okay. Yeah.
That's Noah Young. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, he's not in it very much, but
no.
Noah, I think he really had to be in more Hal Roach shorts than anybody.
Yeah. Him and Gillespie are in every, just,
yeah, because,
just about everything.
Yeah. Because, and Noah, sometimes he's one of the major roles, but then sometimes he'll just come on for like, he's got like a spare 5 minutes and they need somebody. And
yeah.
Like, oh, Noah, go over here and do this, you know?
Yeah.
So. But, and then he actually, at the end of the 20s, I saw him in a George O'Brien Fox film where he's one of their sailors and he's one of George O'Brien's buddies and he had a major role.
Mm.
So he, until sound came in, he did pretty well, but his voice was not good for sound.
Yeah, unfortunately.
He sounded like Mickey's pal Goofy, unfortunately.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you've ever seen the Harold Lloyd film Welcome Danger, his Harold's first talkie, Noah has quite a big role, but he sounds just like Goofy.
Oh,
so
gosh.
It just didn't work out too well, I guess.
Yeah.
But it's a pretty good example of the early snub shorts, I think.
Yeah, and those films survive in varying degrees of really sharp 35 to 16 millimeter rectal prints from the 40s and 50s, and we're happy to share this one with everybody today.
Mm.
So let's let's move on to our sandwich middle, our second short.
The middle of our sandwich.
Nice,
yeah.
to bring in another Keystone comedy. So why don't you tell everybody about Muddled? Muddled in Mud is the Castle Films
that's
version.
That's one of the
this
reissues.
Is, yeah, right. This is a muddy romance that takes place in Echo Lake.
Yes, this is a 1913, and this is a pretty famous Keystone. It has been available for a long time, but it's pretty famous because the main event in the film, Max Sennett found out they were going to drain the lake at Echo Park. Because they were going to put new storm drains in or something. And so they were going to drain the lake and put this in. So he took the opportunity to shoot some scenes in the lake when it was drained, and then they built this comedy around it. And that's always been part of the Senate legend, that he would do that kind of thing whenever he could. You know, if there was a big fire, he'd have the people, his actors, rush over there and improvise something so they could build a comedy around it. Or, you know, things like that. Big parades,
yeah.
and other events that happen.
Yeah. It looks like you have high production values, but you're just sort of stealing a location that happened to be happening. So
yeah.
Why not?
And
yeah.
That's it's really well documented that he did this in this particular one.
Oh, yeah.
And it stars Mabel Norman and Ford Sterling. And, of course, Ford's the villain, as usual. And he does a lot of talking to himself in this one.
Yeah. I jumped again, yeah. Here we
no,
go.
That's okay. This is an early Keystone exhibitor ad because it's got the first two programs. You know, it says a Keystone every Monday. And Cohen Collects a Debt and the Water Nymph were the first Keystone releases. And then the next one was the second. So this is really early. And you can see they're really publicizing Mabel in this ad. And she was known, at the time, she was known as the sugar on the Keystone grapefruit is how they would bill her.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and those first two films, Cohen Collected That and The Water Nymph, were filmed in New York.
Yes.
And Water Nymph was actually filmed in Huntington, New York. I showed it to an audience several years ago, and they identified some locations. So that was before they went out to California. There was
the first
hastily shot in New York. Yeah.
Yeah, the company was incorporated in New York, and they started shooting right away in New York. And they used some supporting people from the Biograph company where Senate had been, when they had been. Well, we showed at Coney Island on one of the earlier watch parties. And that was shot, you know, in New York, actually at Coney Island. But they did that for a while, but then pretty soon they went out to California and they would sort of release the New York ones here and there. Let's see, a muddy romance. Oh, here's another shot of Mabel. And she's on, I wanted to show this because I think you know, she looks so cute with the kids and everything. But also the steps of the house, I think, are in the film because there were houses that they used around the studio over and over.
Yeah, it's a house that we see in a lot of the Keystone
Shorts.
Yeah,
and the little boy sitting on Mabel's lap is Paul Jacobs, who was known as Little Billy. And he did films for Keystone as Little Billy, and then he went to the Sterling Company and was Little Billy for them as well. Mm. And I again, you've got a lot of the regular Keystone players in this, in A Muddy Romance. They turn up as cops. You've got Bill Hauber, you've got Edgar Kennedy, Max Swain, and it's pretty early for Max Swain.
Yeah.
You know, 1913. But there's Charles Avery. And Mabel's, one of her suitors is a guy named Charles Inslee.
Mm, yeah, I thought I recognized him.
This had been the part that Mac would have played, but at this point, Mac is moving more behind the camera.
Yeah.
He directed this, and he's dealing with the finances and with managing the studio at this point.
Yeah.
But Charles Inslee, he had been in Griffith's Biograph Company. He had done films for Bison. He was a Keystone. He'd end up at LKO. He was all over the place in tons of films. And then 1921, he disappears.
Yeah, but he's in the film Work, the Chaplin short. He's Chaplin's...
He's the boss.
He's the boss in the wallpapering job. And they're sort of teamed up in that short.
But he moved
That's
around
where I know
a
him.
Lot.
Yeah.
And people like Linda Arvidsson, who was D.W. Griffith's first wife, and Billy Bitzer later said he was very temperamental. He was very difficult. And he had a couple of fist fights with D.W. Griffith.
Oh,
because he wouldn't do something. Then Griffith was trying to get, you know, when they were working. but Bitzer actually talked about it. Fist fights. So,
yeah.
But I mean, you wouldn't know it from this. But he wasn't. He was only at Keystone for a few months. But so you get to see him. And one thing I just want to mention, you look for the whole opening of the film. In so many early Keystones, everything is through a window.
Yeah.
Where there's characters talking out a window, or they go in a window, or they look in a window. But it's like some kind of fascination with windows.
Yeah.
In these Keystones. So the whole opening is Mabel and Sterling.
Yeah.
You know, talking through their windows.
Yeah. But, and you were starting to mention before, and we should let our folks know the device that we see in a lot of these films where Ford Sterling turns and talks to the camera. And if you're watching a Keystone that's being shown too fast, which is the way they're often shown, it just looks like he's crazy. But I think his on-screen persona is supposed to be a satire of the sneering villain from melodrama, where he'll say, "I know, I'll do this, and then this will happen." So at a more hospitable speed, shall we say, you can see he's like, "I am in love with this person, they're going to become my wife, and I'm going to do this." And so you can see, and it's just the crazy face pulling he's doing, it's supposed to be a spoof, and you can, when you can decode it a little better, it's a lot funnier.
Well, I have to say, he does a lot of it in this particular film.
Oh, no, this is like, are you sure you don't know sound hasn't come in yet?
Yeah,
there's a whole monologue with the spider that comes down for no reason.
And the spider, I was going to say, watch for the spider.
The spider that turns up and shot in excitement the next year. Yeah, just for the, why not? Something else to freak him out. Well, we should get to it. So, we'll watch
the
film. We'll come back and talk a little bit.
We'll talk about the spider after the film.
Yeah, but here's a lot. Yeah. Okay. All right, Mana. You get the lights, please.
Do we have someone?
We do.
For this?
We want it. It's on the Slapstick Encyclopedia, and we want to thank Blackhawk Films Collection and Lobster Films. So, merci, Serge,
merci,
and thank you so
Serge.
Much. And so, Mana, if you'll get the lights.
Yes.
Here is Mabel Normand, Ford Sterling, the Keystone Cops, and a whole lot of mud. And a muddy
and a spider.
And a rubber spider in A Muddy Romance from 1913. Yes, there may be, another dozen feet of film somewhere out there in the universe that finishes all that off. But that's pretty much what survives of a muddy romance and
in very muddy.
Very muddy.
Yeah, very muddy. Yeah. Well, when I was doing my book, Slapstick Divas, and writing the chapter on Mabel, I found an interview where she talks about shooting that.
Mm.
And she said it was terrible, you know, because of all the mud, and they pulled them through the mud, and she said they were covered. And then they take a car back to the studio, and by the time they got to the studio, all the mud was hardened.
Oh,
jeez.
You know, so they're all, you know, so she said it was pretty awful. But, you know, it was a kind of a perfect situation, you know, to do the comedy. And I forgot to mention, Minta's mother is played by Minta Durfee, or Mabel's mother is played by Minta Durfee, who was Roscoe Arbuckle's wife. And she had just joined the company.
Mm.
So she just a few films back. And she's younger than Mabel. She's like 4 years younger than Mabel, but she's playing her mother.
Wow.
Yeah.
You know, she doesn't have much to do. I noticed Sterling starts choking her at one point, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Well, he ran out of things to say.
He ran out of gestures to gesticulate. He had to do something.
Yeah. Mana has a... I'm sorry, Steve. Mana, you had a question?
I have a question from Cousin David. Oh. He asked, was that Echo Park Lake?
Yes.
Yay,
yes.
You guessed right, David.
Yeah, that's definitely in these comedies. It's either Griffith Park or Echo Park, but that's definitely Echo.
Yeah, this is Echo Park. Yeah,
yep.
And so,
yeah.
And what about that spider? I mean, they just so random, you know.
Yeah,
that they
I'm
just
you know
that spider.
That spider turns up again in the Alice Howell comedy. Shot in the excitement. The following year, I'm surprised you don't know the spider's name, Steve.
No. Oh, going back to the Snub Pollard short, you know, there's the dog that's at the opening.
Oh, speaking of dogs, yeah.
But I don't know who he is, but I've seen this dog in a number of like 1919, 1920 shorts. And in one, he smokes a pipe. They have the dogs at the opening, the dog sitting there smoking a pipe and blowing the smoke comes out his nostrils.
Oh, jeez.
And I've seen this dog. He's in a famous shot with Harold from Harold Lloyd with a short called Kicked Out. And it's Harold and the dog kind of, you know, put their heads together. But I've never found a name for that dog, but he's very talented.
Yeah.
They bring him back at the end for the no vacancy gag and stuff.
But
I don't know.
Anyway,
the
spider just comes out of nowhere, and then at the end before he leaves the scene, he looks one more time.
Is that? Oh yeah, he's looking around. Yeah.
Are we doing the spider bit again? No. Just go out the door. Out the door.
Can we milk the spider gags?
Yeah. Keep going. Just keep going out the door. Keep going.
Crazy and fun short.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a classic early Keystone.
Yeah.
I love the way he walks.
Yeah.
It's so goofy.
Yeah, and the one of the things you see him do is that is something you see other comedians do in these films is where before he leaves a shot, he does this little hop. You know, he'll leap in the air, make his legs go up and down, and then he leaves the shot. It's sort of like the old exit stage left, you know.
Yeah.
But I guess you know,
it's a spoof of melodrama convention.
Yeah.
And of course all his face is while he's trying to turn the crank on the you know.
Yeah. If you had a field day,
you know.
Oh yeah. No, it's a lot of fun. If you can some of the films where there's if it's a good print and a good speed and you can really see what he's doing. It's just it's a bit much in this one, but it's once you get what he's doing and what he is, it's more.
Well, he's always funny. He's funnier when a situation is very extreme.
Yeah.
Like when he's strapped into an electric chair or... And the big gestures really work. Or there's one called, I think it's called Only an Office Boy. Mm-hmm. And he's in a safe that gets dynamited into the air, and the safe is flying, and he opens up the door and sits on top of the flying safe, and he's reacting, and it makes
sense. It's justifiable.
Yeah, because it's so extreme, it's so cartoony that all the faces and gestures really work because it's so absurd.
Yeah. So a fun short. So we're going to leap into the 1920s, further into the 20s, with our last film, Sherlock's Home, with Alberta Vaughn, part of the Telephone Girls series. And so, Steve, why don't you tell our friends a little bit about Alberta Vaughn and the film we're about to see.
Okay, well, this, as Ben mentioned, is part of the Telephone Girls series, and this was a series in 1924 of about 10 shorts that were built around Alberta Vaughn and her sidekick Gertrude Short. So here they are. That's Alberta on the left with the beauty mark by, you know, down on her chin. And then Gertie Short is next to her. And they're sidekicks, and they're girls who were phone operators in a hotel. And they did this series of shorts. And Alberta had started her career at Century Comedies. She had been, like, in the early 20s, a leading lady in the comedies. And then she moved over to, Senate. She was in a number of Senate shorts. Mm-hmm. And she also worked with Lupino Lane in his Fox comedy. She was his leading lady. But then in the mid-20s, she started starring in these series that were made by RC Pictures and distributed by FBO. And there was The Telephone Girls, The Pacemakers. There was a number of these. And it's Alberta and the comedy team of Al Cook and Kit Gard, who nobody remembers them at all, that they were a team. But within, like, 4 years, they made a ton of shorts together. Al Cook had been at Max Sennett, and he usually kind of played inebriated characters. And then Kit Gard had worked his way up from being a bit player. He's a bit player in a Marcel Perez short that was shot in Yonkers, Sweet Daddy. He's a thug. He's a guy, he's robbing somebody in that. But then he became a sidekick to Al Cook, and they did about 5 different series of these shorts, and they also did a couple of features, Legionnaires in Paris. Mm-hmm. So they were teamed, and then suddenly in 1928, they're not teamed anymore, and nobody remembers they were a team. Yeah. But Kit Gard continued working, again, as a bit player. He's one of the Marines in Miracle of Morgan's Creek in the 1940s. And Al Cook and Alberta Vaughn did some shorts together, an early sound series, and Alberta did a number of features. She kind of ended up in Westerns in the 1930s, doing a lot of Westerns. And Gertrude Short, she had been a child actor on the stage and in films, and she often played boys when she was very young. But then it became obvious that she wasn't a boy, and she was always kind of the bubbly sidekick. She's in Tilly the Toiler with Marion Davies. She's Marion's sidekick. In the 30s, she's in a lot of features. She's in The Thin Man, and she married the director Percy Pembroke, who's known as Scott Pembroke. And later, she got out of films and started working at Lockheed Air, the air plant during World War II. And she worked there until she retired in the 60s. So she got out of pictures after a while. But this is, you know, it's great to see this series. It's a fun series. And most of the shorts in the series were directed by Mal St. Clair, who went on to become a big director in the 1920s. A lot of features. So I think we should go ahead and take a look at this.
Yeah, we should dive in.
And there's a lot of character people that show up that we'll talk about afterward.
Yeah, and there's another funny lady who you'll recognize.
We won't tell you, but
at the tail end of the film, and that'll be a fun surprise for you. So, we'll dive in now. This is Sherlock's Home with Alberta Vaughn, and this comes to you through the courtesy of Dino Everett and the USC Hugh M. Hefner Moving Image Archive. It's a 16mm print. I think it's the only one that survives, and it's actually also available on the DVD Accidentally Preserved Volume 3 on Undercrank Productions.
That
would be me. But thank you, Dino, and mine. We've got the lights.
Yeah.
we'll watch Sherlock's Home from the Telephone Girls series. Here we go.
Thank you.
Gail Henry. Gail Henry for the win. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. A lot of great character people in this film.
Well, it's almost as if they realized that the audience was going to recognize her.
Oh, yeah, it's like a little star turn at the end.
Because it's
yeah.
kind of a big payoff kind yeah. of thing in a yeah. way. I mean, you know, if you had her, you'd think you'd want to bring her in earlier.
Yeah.
You know, really. So it's obviously that they did it on purpose, bringing her in at the very end.
To beat him up.
Yeah, yeah. And I was this I noticed this series, and there's a couple of other series done by this studio, Racing Blood or something like that.
Blood, The Adventures of Maisie is another yeah. one. With
so
her.
They're all recurring character stories, and then the name you see in the opening title, H.C. Whitwer. Was a I remember when
he
when
was
we
a popular
he was like a Damon Runyon kind of character
yeah, he
writer
wrote stories yeah he yeah. wrote these comedy stories, and he most of those series came from his writings.
Yeah,
so Whitwer was something of a name in the 1920s.
Yeah,
Cosmopolitan magazine.
Yeah, Cosmopolitan magazine. And the Mr. Zanuck, who's credited
Daryl
as a writer.
Francis,
that's
Francis Zanuck. Yes, yeah. it is.
That's Daryl. Yeah.
Wow.
Well, yeah, that's how he started in the business, was as a writer. And he and Mal St. Clair were real buddies, and they worked together a lot in the 20s. In fact, they kind of created the Rin Tin Tin series together with Zanuck writing and Mal St. Clair directing the first couple of those features for Warner Brothers. Yeah. And that's where Zanuck got in at Warner Brothers and became one of their big writers. And then he became a producer for Warner Brothers. But then he left and created his own company, 20th Century Pictures, which then merged with Fox and became 20th Century Fox. I think that was 34.
And didn't he marry Virginia Fox?
From the Buster Keaton films, yes.
From the Buster, yeah. So yes. Daryl Zanuck started Fox, then married Virginia Fox, no relation to Fox films, who we all know from the Keaton shorts, right? Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
Now I was going to ask you because the boy with the freckles, is that Mickey Daniels or is that his brother or something?
No, I think it's his brother Clifford.
Oh, okay.
Because Clifford starred.
Yeah, yeah.
Now I think it's Mickey's brother because he did appear in films in the 1920s for what was that? McDougal Alley. Well, I think he may have appeared with McDougal Alley Kids.
Yeah,
but there was another series, Kids
knockoff
or
of Our Gang,
that he appeared in regularly.
Oh, yeah, regular Fellers, is that it?
Yeah, one of those.
One of those knockoffs. Yeah.
Because there was one that was written by Pinto Colvig.
Oh, okay.
Did the stories, and Clifford was the lead, kind of the Mickey Daniels in that. And those close-ups are pretty scary, actually, of him laughing and grinning. It's really kind of frightening. Yeah. But there's a lot of character people.
When
they get to the town, all the Hicks. You got William Cartwright.
Even I recognize some of them. Yeah.
And Cy Jenks is there, and Dave Morris.
Dave Morris is the guy with the beard, yeah.
Yeah, and Dorothy Vernon, Bobby's mother. There's a number of them that are,
right. And we should definitely mention Beinunsky Hyman, the guy who delivers
of course,
flowers.
Yes.
He gets those big, goofy close-ups in the fighting sequence.
Yeah, these are, again, like Mickey's brother, those close-ups are extreme close-ups of him with the cigarette in his mouth and puffing on the cigarette.
Yeah,
he's got quite a bit to do.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, Mal St. Clair loved these character people because they've got a lot of business. Beinunsky, he goes out when he brings the flowers and candy, but then he opens the door and
he has a little button or two on the scene.
And then he comes back at the fight. They really thought he added a lot to the proceeding.
Because there's no dramatic reason for the flower delivery guy to show up at the fight, but why not?
Why not? Right next to them.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Yeah. But you can see and in some of the series, as they progressed, Kit Gard and Al Cook are really the center of attention. Mm-hmm. I mean, in this series, it's really Alberta Vaughn, and they did more together. But then they did series without her, where they're really, you know, the focal point of the series.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's amazing to me how many films they made together, and it's completely forgotten that they were a team.
Yeah.
And they're funny together.
The ones that do survive, I think the ones that survive, survive in 16mm rental prints from the 30s, like this one.
Pretty much. The Museum of Modern Art has one of these telephone girls.
Oh, that's right.
On 35. Mm-hmm. It's a different one, a different episode, and I can't remember which one, but it's one of the ones directed by St. Clair.
Yeah.
But that's kind of a rarity because it's mostly 16mm that they survive.
Mm.
And they, you know, these were popular. They did a lot of these. So,
yeah. Well, thank you, Dino Everett, and the Hugh M. Hefner, USC Hugh M. Hefner Moving Image Archive, for preserving this and allowing us to share this with everybody.
Yes, Dino.
And so before we sign off, we look at this, what we have from Marlene. It's time for Ben and Steve's Cabin Fever recommendations.
Wow.
And we have some things to remind you and to recommend to everybody who's watching. So, Steve, you have something to recommend to our friends today.
Yes. Now, this is something that I did recommend very early when we first started doing the watch party, but I would like to re-recommend this because it's become more readily available.
Yes.
It's much more available now. Thanks to Ben, actually, was a big help.
Yeah.
Because now this is Tony Susnick's documentary, John Bunny, Film's First King of Comedy, which is a really excellent documentary. But now it's become available on Amazon and the TCM shop and
Deep
many,
Discount
many,
and all sorts of online vendors. In addition to the documentary, there are some John Bunny films as well.
Yeah, there are four John Bunny films from the collection of Library of Congress.
Yeah.
So they look gorgeous and they're funny films. And Tony did a great job. It's a very good documentary. It tells you everything you would want to know about Mr. Bunny, and has Sam Gill and myself are kind of talking heads through a lot of this. But it's Tony did a really nice job. So I'm really happy that it's, you know, so much more available now.
Yeah, because when we've shown John Bunny films on the watch party, people have asked, where can I get more of these?
Yeah.
And is this the documentary that where you and Tony went to
the
Vitagraph buildings?
Yeah, it was
so you
a
can
girl
see what
school.
It looks like. Yeah.
Yeah, the actual building had become a girls' school and was that for many years.
Mm.
And then there's the famous Vitagraph smokestack, which you'll see in the documentary.
Yeah.
But when we were there, the smokestack had scaffolding all around it. We were afraid they're going to tear it down.
Yeah.
They actually tore the school down, and the smokestack is still standing. So.
Yeah.
So it was fun to be there because you really could see a lot of what had been the studio still there.
Yeah.
But so I very much recommend this. It's a lot of fun, and Bunny's a very important figure.
Oh, yes, definitely.
In early film.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Steve. And my recommendation is tied to Steve. For years and years, Mana would ask me, in early December, what do you want for the holidays? What do you want for a present? And I would always say, I want the book that is in the back of Steve's head. And eventually, I bugged Steve and he wrote it. And so if you do not have Lame Brains and Lunatics, The Good, the Bad, and the Forgotten, a silent comedy by Steve Massa, absolutely pick it up. If you're a fan of the silent comedy watch party, and so many of the comments that we got are like, boy, Steve knows so much. I enjoy learning from Steve. And
this is
I'm strongly recommending Lame Brains and Lunatics, available on Amazon and lots of other booksellers. And are you working on a next volume of this?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm currently finishing putting the finishing touches on the sequel. With the clever title, Lame Brains and Lunatics 2.
Oh!
Yeah,
it's that number 2 that really...
Yeah, clever.
More good, bad, and forgotten as silent comedy. But I had toyed, you know, with titles like Son of Lame Brains and Lunatics and things like
that. Yeah, I've been Costello meet Lame Brains, but
Exactly. But it's new essays on different aspects of obscure and overlooked aspects of silent comedy. One of them is we've talked about a lot are the animals.
Yeah.
But there's also piece on Musty Suffer, the director Edward Luddy, the director Leo McCary, what his work at Hal Roach in silent comedy, and the British Music Hall, the effect of the players. There were so many players in silent comedy who came from the British Music Hall, and so much of the material ended up in the film. So there's an essay on that as well. So
that's what I'll be asking Mana about next year.
Next Christmas.
Thank
you, Ben, for plugging.
Oh, yeah. No, it's a great read and an excellent resource. And I should also mention sort of the prequel to this book is if you can find a used copy of Clown Princes and Court Jesters by Sam Gill on eBay or Amazon, pick it up. I also want to mention that I'll be doing a live stream on Tuesday through the Cinema Arts Center of Charlie Chaplin Comedies.
Yeah.
So all the information for that is on the Cinema Arts Center website, or you can find it at my website, silentfilmmusic.com. I do want to let you know that my Silent Film Music podcast has been is back in business. My co-host and co-producer on that, Kerr Lockhart, and I are back in the saddle. And we've released a couple of episodes, and we've got our year-end wrap-up coming up for you. So it's the Silent Film Music podcast, available on most podcasting platforms. But that is episode 70.
Are you playing at MoMA this week?
I am playing at MoMA.
Those
of you who live in New York City, I'll be at MoMA. I'll be at MoMA on Wednesday and Thursday. And all that information is on my website, or if you go to MoMA.org.
And
do this when
Give
I take my
wave.
Little bow at the start of the show. But this is episode 73 of the Silent Comedy Watch Party, a pretty much regularly scheduled live stream. This is really happening right now, live stream silent film show with live music and live introductions with me, Ben Modell, and Steve Massa. Any closing words from you, Steve, before we sign off for the year and send everybody into the rest of their day?
Well, this is, being our pre-holiday show, our last live for the year. I just want to thank everyone for tuning in all year and all their support and all the feeling, the vibes we get, you know, the good feeling from everybody and the support. It's really fantastic. And I'm glad we've been able to present these films, Ben and I, to just, laughter is so important, especially in times like this.
Oh, gosh.
We've been going through. I mean, you always hear that, how important laughter is. And I've always felt that, but never so much so as, the last couple of years. So thank you for tuning in. And, we'll be continuing and bringing laughs to people. I hope everyone has happy holidays, no matter what kind of holiday you celebrate. I hope wonderful holidays and happy new year. And let's all, hope for a fantastic 2022.
Yeah.
So keep laughing and we'll see you next year.
All right. Yay. Thank you. Thanks, happy holidays, Steve. And Merry Christmas to you, Steve and
holidays.
Susan.
Thanks, guys. Thank you, too.
Well, that's our show. I want to echo Steve's heartfelt sentiments. And I want to thank you for watching and for streaming along with us. We're all doing this together. This is a virtual visit that we have every week or every other week. It's meant so much to me and to Mana and to all of us, Marlene, Crystal, Steve, Susan, everybody who's involved with these shows. And it's really doing these shows has affected me, and it's meant so much more than just putting on a show or just getting to play the piano. I've learned so much more about what it means to be an entertainer or to present entertainment from the moment we did our pilot last year and hearing from so many people who needed some kind of relief and release from whatever's been going on. And this year it's been a lot. Mm-hmm. It's still a lot, and we're all going through different things. As we launch our way into next year, we're so glad that we could be together to enjoy these films and laugh together. We're not in the same room, but we're all part of the same audience, even if it's virtually, and even if you're watching the show after now. We're so glad for your support and for the connection we've had through silent film, the unique properties of the silent film universe that we can all just go up into. The way it is for some people with, you know, virtual reality or video games, it's the same way with silent movies. So we're so grateful to you, and thanks so much. Thank you, Mana,
for
everything
Thank
all year.
Everybody.
Thank you, everybody.
It's been so wonderful.
Thank you so much. This has been the Silent Comedy.
Thanks to Susan.
Thank you, Crystal Kay.
Yes, Crystal.
Her husband James and to Lily and to Marlene and Mike.
And Mike.
Mike
and Adam.
And
we love
yes,
all.
And to everybody who has shared allowed us to share films from their video releases throughout the year and into next year, helping us get through whatever we're going through. This is the Silent Comedy Watch Party, a live stream show right here on YouTube for you. Amana, if you'll turn off the lights, I'll play everybody into the rest of their day.
All right.
And I want to wish everybody a happy holiday season, a happy new year. We'll see you again online in January. Thank you. Thanks so much for watching the Silent Comedy Watch Party, a live stream show here on YouTube.
Happy holidays, everybody. We'll see you in 2022.